ECF and the vaccination. When I see Dr. Mugambi here, I know he has a better oversight. And in case of any questions, he might be able to help us if he likes. So I'm just going to take you basically more through the basics of the East Coast fever vaccination as opposed to this method of disease, because being technical people, I know you have a bigger and deeper understanding of the East method of disease. So basically, one important thing about the East Coast fever vaccine is that it's a one shot for life. When the animals are vaccinated, they do not need boosting. The vaccine serves to increase the protection for the rest of their living lives. Just a quick introduction. ECF, as we all know, is a tick-borne protozoan disease. It's caused by Kalrho cover parasites and is normally transmitted by the encephalus appendicularis, which is the ground in the tick. And ECF is currently regarded as the most devastating infectious disease in sub-Saharan Africa. It's very endemic in 11 African countries, and it kills an estimated 1.1 million cats an annual. If you put the price of each cat on, say, 20,000, you can see in terms of millions how much is lost to the economy, and this is basically money that is lost by farmers. And the disease, without technically, basically, the disease is a limitation to productivity, because you know the animal goes down with this, yet the cost of treatment is quite high. Production goes down, and in most cases, if there's delay in treatment, the animal will lose the animal. And especially for the high producing animals in central Kenya and part of the Rift Valley and sometimes in the mountain areas, it's a very costful disease to farmers who are looking to venture into the exotic breeds. But we can also not clean out the masses because they are losing a lot of calves to and that is just a map showing the distribution, the current distribution of the encephalus, that is the tips. You can see it's mostly towards a little bit of the coast within Nairobi Central, part of Western Kenya. So there's actually no ECF towards the northern. The yellow one shows the probable distribution again of the vector, because the vector is which transmits the disease. So in the past, various strategies have been utilized in trying to control ECF with different outcomes. And the most common one is actually use of beets, use of acaricides. And we've had so many challenges of tick resistance to the use of acaricides. So you get farmers who routinely dip or spray their animals, even some week twice in a week, but they still have high incidences of ECF. So the East Coast fever vaccination is done using what we're calling the infection and treatment method. Where basically the animals are inoculated or are injected with the very lethal doses and mostly light sporozoids of tick powder. And then they are given concurrent treatment of 30% oxytetracycline. Currently we have a number of, we have different stabilizers, but the one that is commonly used is the Nguda cocktail, because again it's called cocktail because it has a number of strains incorporated into the vaccine. But we also have the mycarbonic, which is mostly used in the coastal areas because it only has one strain. We also have the chitonge and another strain that are mostly used in Zambia. And the reason the strain is become Nguda cocktail is because it covers both the other type of T-power strains that are transmitted from one life. So if your livestock interact with livestock, the strains that you get from the buffalo, so this also, the cocktail, which has I think three strains, is able to cover that. So its coverage is wide, and that's why we encourage you that this is the preferred vaccine of choice, especially in pastoralist areas where they commonly interact with wildlife. As you said, the vaccine has confers lifelong immunity, and the ECF vaccine, and I know there are people who've done immunology here, as it is one of the vaccines that has the highest immunity cover, with about 95 to 98% protection. So its protection level is actually really high. Simply for you to do a successful ECF vaccination, because again you say it's a very delicate vaccine, and these are live spermatozoids that are being injected to the animal. So you're introducing a very severe disease to the animal. So there are certain criteria that are used for selection of the animal to ensure success to confer the immunity. One of the things is, of course, animal selection, whereby, because it's a disease we're introducing to the animal has to be healthy. Because we need the body to be able to fight the disease and confer the immunity. So the animal has to be healthy. We also do not, we say that for cows, they have to be 1 month and above, because before that, they still have maternal antibodies, which will fight. Which will work to fight the vaccine. We also say animals that are sick are not supposed to be vaccinated. So they have to be well, they have to have been treated. And they are at least 21 days past the last treatment. Animals that are also pregnant, we say the last trimester, because again, we say the cover is 95 to 98%, and they, like in all other vaccinations, there may be a reactor, an animal that will go down full-blown ECF, and if you give it towards the last trimester, and one of the characteristics of the ECF is that it has a high fever. So in such cases, in the last trimester, the animal is prone to go down with stress and probably end up with an abortion. So, and also if you've moved your animals, you've probably just brought your animals and you want to vaccinate immediately, you say give it at least 21 days for it to acclimatize before you introduce the vaccine. The other thing is if you recently dewormed your animals with the vermicelles, because we know the mode of action with the vermicelles, there is a lot of diarrhea, and so the body becomes stressed, the animal loses a lot of water, and I want to believe when you use the vermicelles, the immune system, it's because of the action of having, it's very severe because of the action of having to diarrhea and all that, the immunity system is a bit not, it's a little bit gentle. So we say if you deworm your animals with the vermicelles, you have to give the body at least 21 days to fully recover. So requirements for the ECF vaccination. So we say you need currently the Mbuga cocktail is packaged in doses of 40, and it comes in form of the vaccine is packaged in a straw similar to that of the artificial insemination, which is 0.5 ml. And then it has a diluent that is about 39.5. So you do then you constitute. So currently the packaging for the Mbuga cocktail is for 40 doses. But I understand Marekabuni pays as 10, it's packaged into 10, so you can be able to get the Marekabuni at 10. Then we said, I think I've gone through this, cows at least 1 month old, cows not less than 3 months to calving, cattle or sheep treated within 3 weeks of the vaccination, no levamisole treatment 3 weeks to and after. Then, of course, adequate feed for the vaccinated animals, and then of course, there should be no movement, and then, because it's a very tedious process, we say we need to do proper, there has to be proper restraint mechanism. The materials required for the vaccination is very simple. We have the ECF vaccine straws, which again are strong like the artificial insemination straws, and are liquid nitrogen. And then you need a full box with ice because it comes in, it has a diluent. Once you reconstitute, you need to put it in a full box. Then you need a thermometer and timer to be able, then you need a record card and pen because you need to record. You need a weighing van, syringes and needles because I think when I explain further when I take it through the procedure, unlike the other vaccination, it's not just a jab and go. it's a quite a process, because one, you have to take the do the general examination of the animal to ensure that it's in proper health. Then two, you have to take the weight, and then it's a requirement that you deworm the animals, because you want to reduce the warm lot, which is supposed to help with the immunity. And normally when we deworm within the 10% and less as well, that's what is recommended. After that, you're supposed to give the 30% of tetracycline, and I know there's some from Rogu, and also from Bimeda and Amycin. And the reason as to why we're giving 30% is because we want the animal, once we give the vaccine, it actually starts a disease process in the animal. So if you offer the high dose of 30%, it ensures that the animal is able to get the disease, but not to the, you know, like clinical level. So the 30% will help manage the subclinical ECF, so that it doesn't develop to full blown ECF, because we want the body, the way the vaccine works is that the body is able to develop the disease, then the body will also be able to form complete an immunity against that particular disease. I understand that's how vaccines work. So that's where we give it the 30% of tetracycline. And then after that, we give the ECF vaccine, which is again 1 ml per animal. It's given near the ear, because we are targeting the lymph nodes, and the ear is actually the feeding. We are mimicking the brown ear tip, and because it's the common feeding site is near the ear, near the so that's where we administer the vaccine. After that, we give an ear tag. So this ear tag is a form of certification that your animal has been vaccinated. So normally it will be written here in this ear, it has a specific ear tag number, and that's what we need the record card and the claim for. Because whoever is doing the vaccination is in record, and if the farmer comes up with a complaint and says my animal went down with this ear, this is the only evidence that we have to show that actually the animal has been vaccinated. The office of the DVS, there are a number of distributors in the country who have been appointed by the office of the DVS, and each distributor has a certain color code for their ECF tags. So depending again on the color code, you can be able to know who of the different distributors have administered this particular vaccine. And then, as I said, we give the 10% albendazole to knock off the warm load. Because one of the problems I think our farmers are doing, because most farmers are deworming the animals, they are serious under dosage. Because again, farmers do not take the right weight. If you ask a farmer, how do you take your weight, most of them will say estimation. And I want to think that's what us also technical people do. Do we always, I mean, when you go to the farm, how many of us use weighing bands to measure the weight of the animals before we offer any service? We estimate using our eyes. Okay. So I want you guys to assume I'm a cow. Can someone tell me how much, what is my weight? we are saying that's the reason as to why people say we need to do the 10% and the oxygen. And then we said you have the ECF branded ear tags, and then of course you need protective clothing and restraint facility, because you can see it's a very tedious activity. You have to restrain, you have to take the weight, you have to be warm, you have to inject, and you know that how 30% oxygen to settle. And you're probably dealing with the Maasai zebus or sarions or all those aggressive animals. Basically, this is just a tool showing the ECF vaccine. So you need, of course, you need the drench, something to help you with the drench. You need the oxytet, the ear tag applicator, and then you need, that is the cold chain, and the ECF and the personnel. So we've said, one because the vaccine is stored under liquid nitrogen, you have to pour it just the way you want to administer the way you want to do artificial insemination. I think if you all went through that school, I'm sure you went to that family in Nairobi to do PD, or you did after Karibu na Mandela, you were able to do train on AI. Then you need to throw the stabilizer. So by rubbing it in between your arms, then you reconstitute the two. Then you allow them to break. So after reconstituting, you put them in the cool box for another about 30 minutes. So again, this is just a vaccination procedure. We say you need to examine the animal. You can inject the 30% you need to form, and then you inject the stabilizer. Again, you say near the carotid of the prescapula, then you tap the animal. So that is how the ECF straw looks like. Currently, I understand, through government, the ECF vaccine is being produced at the Center for Tick and Tick Disease in Malawi, Lilongwe. But Sudan is the local technical representative, so they get to import the vaccine, and then anyone else who is interested in doing the vaccination is able to get. This is for the Mbuga Kote, and so this is the vaccine after reconstitution, and that is just the simple vaccination process. So again, something very critical, because you say, remember I said these are lethal sporozoids that are being introduced to the animal. It's important to do a post-vaccination follow-up with the animals. So one is you need to closely monitor the animals, because they're made places of reactors where the animals will go down with full-blown ECF. In that case, you need to treat with the antimalarial drugs that are available on the market. Then you need to continue dipping weekly. It takes about 21 days for the immunity to set. So you need to continue weekly dipping or spraying for 4 weeks, at least past vaccination. Then in the long run, the farmers are advised to reduce the frequency of dipping, but they need to continue dipping because of other tick-borne diseases. Most farmers will think once you vaccinate, then you don't have to worry about the other diseases that are related to tick. But it's important to let them know that they still need to continue dipping. The immunity against TCF is self-mediated, and therefore we are saying that a constant tick challenge is vital to ensure sustainable immunity. But I think this is not really an issue, because they have healthier drugs that are able to grow. So this is just an example of the